So we are going to start off reading in the Gospel of Matthew. I'm actually going to read the whole genealogy to start off with. And then we're going to talk about a few things here. This is kind of the stuff that we typically skip over whenever we're in a Bible reading process, because it's like, what do all these names really even matter? Well, there's truths that are oftentimes found within these genealogies. Well, not oftentimes, all the time. And they have connections. But anyway, we'll see where the Lord goes this morning. Chapter 1, Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. The book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham begat Isaac, and Isaac begat Jacob, and Jacob begat Judas and his brethren. And Judas begat Phares of Zerah of Tamar, and Zerah of Tamar, and Phares begat Esrom, and Esrom begat Aram. And Aram begat Amminadab, and Amminadab begat Nahson, and Nahson begat Salmon. And Salmon begat Boaz of Rahab, another name for Rahab, and Boaz begat Obed of Ruth, and Obed begat Jesse. And Jesse begat David the king, and David the king begat Solomon of her that had been the wife of Urias. And Solomon begat Rehoboam, and Rehoboam begat Abiah, and Abiah begat Asa. And Asa begat Josaphat, and Josaphat begat Joram, and Joram begat Ozias. And Ozias begot to Joatham, and Joatham begot Achaz, and Achaz begot Ezekias. And Ezekias begat Manasseh, and Manasseh begot Amon, and Amon begat Josias. And Josias begat Jeconias and his brethren about the time they were carried away to Babylon. And after they were brought to Babylon, Jeconias begat Siliathil, and Siliathil begat Zerubbabel. And Zerubbabel begat Abiud, and Abiud begat Eliakim, and Eliakim begat Azor. And Azor begat Sadoa, and Sadoa begat and Sadoc begat Acham, and Acham begat Eliud. And Eliud begat Eleazar, and Eleazar begat Mathan, and Mathan begat Jacob. And Jacob begat Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called the Christ. So all the generations from Abraham to David are 14 generations, and from David until the carrying away into Babylon are 14 generations, and from the carrying away into Babylon unto Christ are 14 generations. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise, when as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. All right, so that's really the only part that I wanted to talk about as far as the genealogy. I really wanted to focus on the genealogy. But there was four different women that were noted in the genealogy. Everybody else was men. And the four women, we had Tamar. We had a version of the name. Her name is Rahab, but the New Testament translates it a little bit different. We have the name of Ruth. Now, the fourth woman, she wasn't mentioned. Her name wasn't mentioned, but she was referred to as the wife, and her husband's name, Uriah, was given. But that woman there is Bathsheba. And I wanted to talk to you a little bit about these women and their stories this morning, and I wanted to connect things that happened in their life to things that can oftentimes, well, do happen in the lives of us today. I also was trying to think of just one simple word that describes, I guess, the points that I'm trying to get across. I don't know if I really was able to do that or not, but this is what I'm trying to do, and I'll try to explain it to you here in a second. That there's various things on this earth that affect us, right, in our lives, and really make us the people that we are. But I got to tell you that no matter what we've been through, the reality of it is that we've all experienced similar type circumstances because of the fall. We've talked about that a lot, the way the fall has affected people and the things that have happened to people. And in your life, there's various circumstances that develop who you become. You understand what I'm getting at? And they develop who you become. And really, God is offering new life in Christ. Amen. And that's really what the gospel teaches. But the truth of the matter is that there's various things that happen to us in various circumstances along our life that do have an impact on our lives. We may not even, some people aren't even willing to think about all of these things. And I'll be honest with you, some of this stuff, whenever I began to look at what I had written and what I felt like the Lord was leading me down a certain pathway, I started to even kind of wonder in my own head, you know, this is a little bit different than the way that you've thought before. But just because I was thinking one way doesn't mean that I always think the right way. Amen. And I'm willing to admit that to you. I guess what I was going to say about regarding Tamar, and we'll get into each one of these. What I mean by position is this. Is that a lot of times in life, there's people that have elevated positions and people that have lower positions. When we get into the specifics of the story, I'll try to bring out and maybe make it more real for our lives. But just to make a long story short, there's people that have power and people that have less power. And it can be in individual relationships. It can be at the workplace. It can be in society as a whole. But nevertheless, it's very common that people that are in powerful positions or have more power or strength over someone else take advantage of those people that have less power and less strength. And we don't even think about it. But the reality of it is that that can affect people and their mindset in the way that they view life, in the way that they view other people, and even the way that they view relationships as they move forward. I don't know that I've stepped back enough and thought about how my behavior affects other people. I mean, I think about it more than a lot of people, but I don't think I think about it enough. So the first thing regarding Tamar and her story regards position. The next one with Rahab, I felt like I could break it down and just say simply knowledge. Now, when I say knowledge, I'm not talking about knowledge. They talk about knowledge is power, right? And if you'd swear, if you listen to politicians today, that if we just would make some better schools, and don't get me wrong, I'm all about better schools. I'm all about education. I'm all about people being able to spell and put commas in the right place. I really am. I can't stand it whenever we don't spell right. I know that I make mistakes too. But the point that I'm trying to make is you can make all the best schools. You can teach people their alphabet at the right time. They can start being able to spell. They can do all of that is so important. I'm all about that. That is not what's going to fix society. You can give people all the knowledge that you want to give them. If their heart is still void of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, then they will be real smart and still split hell wide open and still cause damage to people's lives as they live their life. I'm talking about knowledge about God. Rahab represents people who need knowledge about God. And if they just be given that little piece of knowledge, you'd be amazed what would happen in certain people's lives whenever they experience that piece of knowledge, right? Yeah. Okay. Ruth, to me, she represents motivation. Really, another word would probably have been better stated, hunger. Because that's really, in my mind, when I started looking at it from a different perspective this time, really the book is built upon, at least to some extent, a concept of hunger, because there was a famine in the land. And there's some things that are driving people forward, right? People are hungry for something. And we're going to talk about Ruth in the sense of really regarding hunger. And then Bathsheba, she just found herself in an unexpected situation. You know, the reality of it is that sometimes, especially as preachers, you know, whenever we get into the Word, I desire so much not to be a seeker-sensitive preacher, you know, to not so carefully choose my words that I'm going to be scared that I don't offend someone. I'm just not about that. At the same time, the reality of it is that sometimes, and so what I'm saying is that we preach against sin, right? The reality of it is that sometimes people find themselves in unexpected situations. They weren't looking for it. Don't get me wrong. Each and every one of us in this room have experienced a situation where we went looking for sin. Come on. You don't have to raise your hand. You don't even have to shake your head. I know that each and every human being born of Adam has sought out sin. We found ourselves in places we had no business being, doing things we had no business doing, and did it more than one time. At the same time, I'll say this. Bathsheba represents somebody that wants to live for God, and at the same time found herself in an unexpected situation that completely turned her life around, and now she's caught off guard, and it's completely changed everything that she ever knew before. And so as we move forward with this particular message, I guess I just want to say that if I was going to title it, I would just title it something simple as bringing us a king, or bringing the king to a broken people, you know? And I just don't find it accidental that God, in these four women that he describes, their stories, and we're going to actually just read their stories. I think it's important that we read the Bible. And we're going to see these amazing stories and how it's amazing to me that God would use these particular women the way that he did. But in reality, if we take the time, we can connect ourselves to their situations and we can see exactly why God use these particular women, because they're real people in a real world that experienced things that, even though they were ancient compared to where we are today, we still experience these types of things today. And because of these things, these are just some examples. There's a whole lot more out there, obviously, of ways that people can be hurt and jaded and even view God from a strange perspective. And the whole time, all he's doing is he's bringing King Jesus to us as a gift to connect us back to him. Amen? All right. So in reality, what we saw here was the genealogy of Jesus and his physical birth. And, you know, they can put it on the screen if they want to, but Hebrews 2:14, I quote this scripture a lot. We see that this is why ultimately Jesus had to come. Out of Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14, it says, "For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, death that is the devil." So what we see in the genealogy of Jesus Christ, whether it be in Matthew's genealogy, which really brings it back to Joseph, who was of the royal lineage of King David, or Luke, who tells us Mary's genealogy, which she also, her family came from the royal, from not the royal lineage, but the lineage of David. What we need to understand is that you and I are human beings. I know you know that, but that's the whole point in telling the genealogy, is that God is explaining that God became a man. Amen. And because you and I were partakers of flesh and blood, he became us. He became our, the one scripture says he's our brother, he's our kindred. And he became us because he came for a specific purpose. And the specific purpose was to die on the cross, to take our sin upon himself, so that reconciliation could be provided between us and the Father. What do you mean by reconciliation? The sin that was in our lives, born of Adam, separated us from the presence of God, but God has a plan. And so when we look at Tamar, we got to go all the way back to Genesis chapter 38. She's our first woman or mother in the lineage of Jesus that we were going to take a peek at here. And I say we read a good portion of the story. All right, starting in verse 1, chapter 38, Genesis 38, verse 1. "It came to pass at that time that Judah," now y'all know who Judah is, right? Just in case we got some you know, people here that hadn't been with us the whole time. But just so that you understand a little bit of where we are, you know, God called this man named Abraham out. Now, y'all, if y'all are tired of me saying this, please forgive me. But God called this man named Abraham out, and he gave him a promise. Anybody, hey, Bible trivia was so fun last night. Anybody remember what the promise that he gave him was? The promise that God gave Abraham was that he was going to make a nation out of him. Mm-hmm. I like to look at the story this way. Like when you go to Genesis chapter 10 and 11 and you see the Tower of Babel, and that not all these people have come together and corporately rebelled against God, and then God causes a confusion of the languages and causes the people groups to spread over the earth, now creating nations along the way. That's where the nations came from, separate nations. And when you turn the page to chapter 12, God goes about the business of creating his own nation, because he calls one specific man named Abraham out. Here's my little map right here. This is Sea of Galilee, Jordan River, Dead Sea, and this is the western border of Israel. Well, there's two rivers over here, and this is Babylon. God called this man named Abraham out of Ur of the Chaldees, southern portion of Babylon, and he said, "I'm going to make a nation out of you." The nation that ultimately came out of Abraham hundreds of years later was the nation that we now know as Israel. But God, Abraham had a son named Isaac, and Isaac had a set of twins, and one of those twins' name was Jacob. Jacob, okay? And Jacob had four sons, and one of his names was Judah. And Judah had ultimately came from him, King David. And from King David, we know, came Jesus, right? And so this is the lineage, and this is why we look at these genealogies, because the whole Bible is pointing towards Jesus coming. So where we are now in this time frame of this story is we're talking about this name right here, specifically Judah. Before there was ever a tribe named Judah, there was a man named Judah. Does that make sense? And we're talking like, you know, hundreds of years before the tribe was ever in existence, the man named Judah existed, and God had given promises to this man named Judah and given promises to his offspring that from him the King of Kings would come, that would have an eternal throne upon which he would rule. But at the same time, God's given him promises, just like God's given you promises. God's spoken things, I'm sure, to your life. Yet at the same time, you have to live out your Christian experience. You have to live out this thing that we call life. And real life sometimes gets in the way because we stand in the way of what God is desiring to do, right? And no different with Judah, to be honest with you. God gave great promises to Judah, and here we see in the midst of this story some things that happened that are absolutely amazing. And so I just wanted you to know who we were talking about. So it says right here, Judah went down from his brethren and turned into a certain Adullamite whose name was Hira. And Judah saw there a daughter of a certain Canaanite whose name was Shua. And he took her and went in unto her. And she conceived. Now, you see, there's a problem right there. I mean, I didn't even see this morning whenever I was reading the passage of Scripture. But to remind myself, you weren't even supposed to do that. The reality of it is that God has been specifically given instruction to his people that they were not supposed to interconnect themselves with women of the world. What did that mean? Women of other nations who were considered Canaanite or of other false religions that worship false gods. God's reasoning behind that was that if you intermarry with them, they're going to pull your heart away from me, and they're going to cause you to put your heart upon the gods of this world. Okay, let's bring this back down to 2016. The reality of it is that even in this room and in churches that are bigger than this, there are people who many times are single, or I'm over here trying to raise daughters anyway, and believe me, I've pounded them. I'm to the point now where I'm not giving up because I don't think that they're doing it, but the point is that I'm done talking to some extent. I'm not saying I'll never talk again, because every time I say that, I end up finding myself talking again. But what I'm trying to say is that I've tried to warn them repeatedly. You know, I'm not trying to talk about some man that's perfect, because if you're looking for that, you ain't never going to find it, right? I mean, come on. Jesus has come and gone. But what I am trying to talk about is a man that wants to live for God, period. When you, or a woman that wants to live for God, when you connect yourself to a Canaanite, what is that? That's a person that's in the world. They ain't got no desire to serve God. Sometimes they'll think that they're serving God, and the reality of it is that they don't want to serve God. They're serving the world, and they're going to continue to serve the world. And now you're going to go connect yourself with them, and when you connect yourself with them, they are going to draw your heart away from serving God, because they are involved in things of the world. Now, to the wife or the husband who says, okay, well, I married her, and when I married her, or I married him, and when I married him, neither one of us were saved, and now I'm saved and they're not saved. Now what I do, preacher? You keep on living for Jesus, and you keep on praying for him, and you keep on allowing Jesus to live through you, amen, to the point that it will rub off on, hopefully he will begin to see the love of the Lord in your life and have a desire also to live for the Lord. But I can't promise you, listen, I'm a realist. You know, I can't promise you that means that they're going to come. Amen. The reality of it is this. I know you want me to say something different, right? That's what you want me to do. Well, I never heard a preacher say it like that before. They always told me that my whole family was going to come in. I can't tell you who's going to bow their knee to Jesus and who's not. Amen. I can't tell you that. But I know what your responsibility is. If you are married and your responsibility is to stay married, amen, and to serve God, then you have to learn by the grace of God to love that person, or else you can be miserable in the midst of the situation and they never going to come to the Lord, and you're never going to be happy either. You know, it's not all dependent on you, but at the same time, you're going to have to make the choice that you're going to live for God no matter what the situation. The scary thing comes in, you know, you're going to have people even in marriages that they both serve God and ain't happy. Okay, but the scary part is that the person that's saved ends up being in that relationship, and the person that's unsaved draws them away.
That's a lot of time.
Happens all the time. And you can't tell me that it doesn't. Because the reality of it is that the enemy will use them, just like the enemy uses people that don't even want to be used by the enemy. And he will slowly and insidiously try to pull you away a little bit at a time. They don't even realize they're doing that. They don't realize that that's what they're doing. I know that the enemy's probably, I'm sure he's used me in people's lives. The reality of it is, you don't know. You don't know when the enemy, when you say something negative to someone and you tear them down, you don't realize that's what the enemy is doing. He's using you as a vessel. You understand what I'm getting at? But the point that I'm trying to make is this, is that he already made a mistake, Judah. I went off on a rabbit trail. Judah already made a mistake. He connected himself to a woman who was of Canaanite descent, who didn't know the God of Abraham and did not know the God that was bringing humanity a king down the line. And the reality of it is now he's connected himself to her. And that's exactly why all the trouble starts to begin with. All right? And so here comes the trouble. It says, and she conceived and bare a son, and he called his name Ur. She conceived again and bare a son, and she called his name Onan. And she yet again conceived and bare a son, and called his name Shelah. And she was at Kezeb when she bare him. And Judah took a wife for Ur, his firstborn, whose name was Tamar. And Ur, that's who we're talking about. We're talking about Tamar. And Ur, Judah's firstborn, was wicked in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord slew him. You see, Judah connected himself with this woman, and now she's had all these boys, and the firstborn of what she had was wicked in the sight of the Lord. And it had something to do, I'm telling you, where his mama came from. All right? Because she probably taught her kid, how many people can agree that your mama taught you some stuff when you were growing up, right? And she either taught you some good stuff, or she taught you some bad stuff, or a little bit of mixture of both. And the reality of it is that there's no way in the world that you can't convince me that this mama didn't teach her boy some things. And the Lord slew him. Judah said unto Onan, go in unto your brother's wife, marry her, and raise up seed to your brother. See, that's the way they did it in the Old Testament. This is the way later on when Israel would become a nation, God gave them laws. This is how they took care of these widows, that if there was a brother that would survive, he would actually impregnate marry her, not just impregnate her, marry her, get her pregnant, have offspring with her so that she had a living heir and so that she could be taken care of. It was a whole lot different back then for women than what it is today. I mean, we're happy that women can have a job and they can have their own checking account. I mean, I don't say that negatively, you know, that's a good thing, you know, that the way that things have progressed. But you got to understand, in the context of the way the Bible was written, it wasn't like that for women. They were, once again, we're talking about position. In position, women were down here, men were up here. Men had power over women, and they were very susceptible to the things that were going on in the midst of life. And unfortunately, to some extent, that is a lot of times still the case when it comes to gender in many cases. Okay, but anyway, I don't want to get into that too much. All right, so it says right here that, so Onan, verse 9, knew that the seed... knew that the seed should not be his, and it came to pass when he went in unto his brother's wife that he spilled it on the ground, lest that he should give seed to his brother. It is what it is. What you just heard is what happened. And so he was supposed to have heir, and instead what he did was he wasted it on the ground purposefully because he didn't want to have offspring with her. Because he, see, now from the man's perspective, that this could end up decreasing his value, because now if he's got children with another wife that he cared more about those children, now whenever it gets old and his inheritance is split up, some of it goes to this other child. And unfortunately, that's the way human beings think in their mind. You see, they're very diabolical whenever they do various things. Well, because of what he did, the Lord also slew him. Then said Judah to Tamar, his daughter-in-law, remain a widow at your father's house till Shelah, my son, be grown. For he said, lest peradventure he die also as his brethren did. And Tamar went and dwelt in her father's house. And I got to tell you that this was a great disgrace for a woman in ancient days. For a woman to not have offspring was a great disgrace. It meant, you know, whether it was because her womb was barren or whether it was because she could not find herself to in a situation where she was married. I just have to tell, I know it's hard maybe for us to wrap our minds around that, although I do believe that it's probably a desire in a woman's heart to have a child. After seeing them go through it, I don't really completely understand it, but nevertheless, it's a desire that they have. But in ancient society, it was a negative thing connected to the woman when she didn't have it was like she didn't have any blessing in her life. Okay, and so this is what Judah's doing is he's telling her, you just got to go live with your daddy, girl. You look, two of my boys already died. You go live with your daddy. When my youngest boy grows up, then we'll go ahead and we'll hook you up with him too, and we'll take care of it, and we'll make everything right. But in the meantime, you go back and you live at your daddy's house. So basically, he put a big stain on her, and he sent her away. And it says in verse 12, and in the process of time, the daughter of Shua, Judah's wife, died, and Judah was comforted. He went up unto his sheep shearers in Timnath, and he and his friend Hira, the Adullamite, and it was told Tamar, saying, behold, thy father-in-law goeth up to Timnath to shear sheep. And she put her widow's garments off from her, and covered her with a veil, and wrapped herself and sat in an open place, which is by the way to Timnath, for she saw that Shelah was grown, and she was not given unto him to wife. So she was watching and observing all this stuff that's happened. She's seen the boy. The boy's all grown up now. He's a man, and Judah still got me stuck over here at my daddy's house. And so she changed her clothes. She put on a veil. When Judah saw her, he thought her to be a harlot because she had covered her face. He turned into her by the way and said, go to, I pray thee, let me come in unto thee. For he knew not that she was his daughter-in-law. And she said, what wilt thou give me that thou mayest come in unto me? And he said, I will send thee a kid from the flock. That means a goat. Now, that's the way they did that. So she's dressed up like a harlot. Judah's wanting to go get a moment of time with her. And he's wanting to know, what do you require for payment for this transaction that we're about to have? And so she asked him, what will you give me? And he's willing to give her a goat. That may not seem like much, but not only did it provide meat, but it also would provide milk, and it was something, you know. So anyway, it's kind of hard for us to wrap our mind around that, but that was what the deal was. In the meantime, she says, well, what will you give me for a pledge? In other words, what kind of proof can I have that you're going to come back and give me this goat that you're promising me? He said, well, what pledge shall I give you? In other words, what do you want? She said, I want your signet, which was a ring that he would wear. I want your bracelets and your staff that is in your hand. And he gave it to her and came in unto her, and she conceived by him. All of these things that she wanted from him were connected directly to his person, and they proved who his identity was. That signet ring was something that they would use to put a wax seal on a letter or whatever the case, and so it showed who his identity was. It says right here, verse 19, she arose and went away and laid by her veil from her and put on the garments of her widowhood. And Judah sent the kid by the hand of the friend of the Adullamite to receive his pledge from the woman's hand, but he found her not. She didn't want that goat. Then he asked the man of the place, saying, where is the harlot that was openly by the wayside? And they said, there was no harlot in this place. And he returned to Judah and said, I cannot find her. And also the men of the place said that there was no harlot in this place. And Judah said, let her take it to her, lest we be shamed. Behold, I sent this kid, and thou hast not found her. And it came to pass about 3 months later that it was told Judah, saying, Tamar, your daughter-in-law, has played the harlot, and also, behold, she is with child by whoredom. And Judah said, bring her forth and let her be burnt. When she was brought forth, she sent to her father-in-law, saying, by the man whose these are, am I with child? And she said, discern, I pray thee, whose are these, the signet and the bracelets and staff? And Judah acknowledged them and said, she has been more righteous than I, because that I gave her not to Shelah, my son, and she knew, and he knew her again no more. Now I got to tell you, if you follow the genealogy through, you see she ends up having twins. And one of her sons is named Perez. And from Perez, we get the genealogy again of Jesus from Joseph's side. And so we see in this story, this is a, I mean, I don't want to call it, say the word crazy related to it, but it's like, what is going on here? This is, who could have even concocted or thought of such a thing? But the reality of it is that when I go back to position, what I want you to know is this, is that Judah had power over Tamar. Not only was it because the fact that she was a woman in society, but and that he was powerful in the sense that he was wealthy, but you know, there were other things involved. And the fact of the matter is that he just had the upper hand in the situation. She was dependent upon him. And I got to tell you that, unfortunately, many times whenever people have power, and we've already discussed this a little bit, when people have power over other people, they'll take advantage of the person that's weaker. I started thinking about all kind of scenarios where this could be true. And I wasn't even really thinking about it before, but I started thinking about even in relationships of father-son, mother-son, mother-daughter, whatever the case, children, parents and children. You know, the parent has all kinds of advantage and authority. Now, for a good parent, that can be a good thing, right? A parent who desires to raise their children the right way, that can be a good thing, because we're supposed to have authority over our children. But when we live our lives in selfishness, just pretend for a moment that you're void from the understanding of God, and that the reality of it is that you're more consumed with yourself than you really are anything else, how easily you can exert power over a child and begin to manipulate situations without even realizing, because that's just who you are, that's what you're doing. So now you create an atmosphere for this child that you've been manipulating them all of your life. You can be a Christian and manipulating your kids because you want them to do what it is that you want them to do. Don't get me wrong, if you're wanting them to do what God wants them to do, fine. You're supposed, you have more wisdom than they do. You have more understanding than they do, and you're supposed to help lead and guide them in the right direction. But if you're just manipulating young minds and twisting young minds to go in a direction just because that's the direction you want them to go, then what you're doing is you're exerting, because of a position situation, because you have power and they don't, you're beginning to create an atmosphere for them that can cause them to become angry, whether it be at any type of authority figure. I'm just going to be honest with you. I know that some of this is true because without my dad realizing it, the way that he treated me as a young boy growing up, it definitely caused me to have an authority problem. I mean, I'm like, dude, I don't want to listen to nut you got to say the way you're acting. And as I grew up, I didn't want to listen to nut that you wore, for whatever reason, if you wore a badge or you wear a uniform or you were a teacher or you showed, I mean, I was just unruly. And everybody that had any level of authority in my life, I was just like, I'm going to rebel against the system. And we don't think about it sometimes, but when we see people act in this particular way, and I'm not trying to get all psychological on you, I'm just being real, that it may not have been their parents, it might have been something else, but somebody who probably had authority in their life, position over them, used that position in a wrong way, and began to push them down and oppress them. I think of kids today, now it's all about the bullying thing. Man, I'm not promoting fighting, but you can't even get in a fight in school anymore without them calling the police. It's gotten so bad. And it wasn't just so much the fighting thing, because I'll be honest with you, I was a bully in school, and one day, I doubt he watched David Baker put a pop knot on my head, and I needed that pop knot. I'm just going to be honest with you. I needed that. It was like a good spanking that boy put on me, and I needed it because I was a bully, and I was over there trying to I was wreaking havoc in people's lives. I guess because I felt like I was bullied, and then I turned around and I bullied other people. But you can't hardly, but that's what a bully does. And listen, sometimes it's just verbal nowadays. I mean, and they do stuff on, you know, social media. I mean, that's another reason why I can't stand social media. People say things about people, you know, and they tear people down. And we don't even think about the things that we say or do to people and how it can hurt them. And it's just tearing people down. So it's not bad enough that they get it from their house, but now they go to school and people are beating them up and dogging them. And you know how it is, man. I mean, you pick somebody out in the crowd, and I used to be like, I don't know, I think I had a radar for that kind of thing. Like the least little deficiency that somebody had, it was like magnified in my mind, and I like went straight for it like a hawk on some kind of rodent, and just like pounding people about that kind of thing. And I thank the Lord that whenever God got a hold of me, I'm not saying that I still don't see it. I mean, the crazy thing is we all have deficiencies. You understand what I'm getting at? So it's like, have you looked at yourself in the mirror? Because you're certainly not made in perfection. I mean, you got your own. You don't want people making fun of you. But the reality of it is that that's what we do. We beat up on people. And we see, and little kids are great at it, man. They'll see like one little thing that's wrong with somebody, and it's like, boom. And I'm thinking to myself, dude, what if I turned around and started doing that to you? Sometimes y'all gotta pray for the preacher, because I'm gonna be honest with you, I'm still a kid at heart. If I see one kid beating up on another kid, or if one kid starts picking on me, you might be surprised if you walk outside the door and you hear me say, yeah, well, blah, 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 blah. It's because the kid probably already jumped on me and he said, he didn't like something about the way that something looked. Because believe me, they got kids in the church that'll tell me about myself. All right. And that's cool. I'm not saying it's the right way to handle it. But what I'm trying to get at is that's just a bully perspective. I'm just talking about position. I'm spending a lot of time on this. But, I started thinking about race relations, too. I'm not the kind of person, really, to be honest with you, I think that sometimes this stuff's overdone. But at the same time, and the reason I say it, I'm talking about now. I'm not saying that it wasn't a reality in the past. I'm just talking about now. But maybe it's because God's done a work in my heart. I just remember when I was a kid growing up, dude, we had a problem in our school. You know what I'm saying? I mean, dude, there was some major antagonism between my, we played football together, we played baseball together, but there was just something wasn't right. And do y'all still feel that? Because I don't feel that anymore. But it might just be because of something that's happened in me personally. But I can remember, like, there was just a constant fight. I'd see some dude. I go to school with this guy, and I happen to be on the other side of town, and I'm riding down the road, and he hollers, I'm about to steal your tennies. I'm like, dude, you come try to steal these tennies, and it's going to be on, dude. We're going to be rolling around in the gravel, right? But the point that I'm trying to make is that there was a lot of antagonism. And I don't feel it like I used to, but I do believe that it does still exist. And we can say whatever we want to say, but the reality of it is that there have been certain races and cultures that have been held down and people that have position over them. And so what I'm trying to get at is we may not understand it. We might not think that it really is legitimate, but you didn't grow up that way. So you don't really know. I didn't grow up that way, and so I don't really know. And so I have no right to assume that it really shouldn't affect them. Just like if your daddy didn't treat you a certain way, you don't know what it was like to be treated that particular way. So what I'm trying to say is that we don't understand really what makes other people tick. We don't understand why people make the decisions that they make. But Tamar represents somebody who, because of a lower place in society, she was taken advantage of. And the result of her situation is that she tried to take matters in her own hand and she tried to remedy the situation. The same thing can happen even at the workplace. People you can be taken advantage of. And so many times when we find ourselves in these situations, we try to remedy them on our own. We come up with our own plans. But what I'm here to tell you is that God was in the process of bringing Jesus, and he is the answer to it. You're not going to fix it. Amen. If you were bullied and you turn around and try to bully, that ain't going to fix nothing. If you feel like somebody's treating you wrong at work and you're going to jump over to another job, because you're going to fix, that ain't going to fix nothing, because now you still got to deal with the same thing that you were dealing with at the other place. We've been talking a lot about work here lately, through the different books and the fact that employers are supposed to give to employees what's due them. But the reality of it is that sometimes that doesn't happen either, right? And I've heard stories of people who, you know what they did? They just sucked it up. And they did what they were supposed to do. Because you can come up with all kinds of excuses. Oh, the man's trying to hold me down. Or they don't want to treat me right. And this, they still, this and whatever. You can come up with excuses or a dime a dozen, man. But, I was working out with this guy the other day that I've gotten to be good friends with. And he's a Christian. He's been living for the Lord all his life. He's a policeman. I'm not going to say his name because, he didn't give me permission to. But I was just sitting there talking to him. And I was like, dude, how long you been with the police force? He said, man, I started when I was, I can't remember how old he said, 20, 21. I said, well, how long you got left? He said, man, I'm going to retire in 4.5 years. He's going to be 47. He's going to be 47. He said, and I'm retired, and I'm going to get 83% of my check for the rest of my life, and I'm going to go find a job doing something that I want to do. I said, boy, I bet there was a lot of times along the way when you wanted to drag up. He's like, dude, you don't want to talk. But you know what he did? He sucked it up. He sucked it up. He stayed faithful. He endured the trial. And he went through. There's a blessing at the end of it, amen, for that particular situation. I feel like in today's society, we don't understand that anymore.
Right.
But the reality of it is that sometimes because of our position, sometimes because we're lower, people will take advantage of us. But you cannot fix the situation like Tamar did. Don't get me wrong. God still worked through it all. And you might make mistakes in your life, and God can work through that also. But the reality of it is God wants us to learn how to trust him in the midst of situations and to believe that he will take care of it. I was going to tell you that the main thought I wanted you to get out of this was that for you, if you find yourself in a situation like Tamar, that God is really your defender. I was going to bring you to Isaiah 54. I was going to try to break that down. I'm going way too long on this first point to do that. But one of the last verses in Isaiah 54 says that no weapon formed against you will prosper. Really, if you go back and read Isaiah 54, I feel like it's amazing because I didn't really plan it that way. But when I went back and really started studying, I was thinking you could almost say this chapter in Isaiah, which was probably about 1,500 years after Tamar's life, was almost written for her personally. It's really talking about Israel as a nation, but it was almost like it was written for her personally because it talks about the barren womb. It talks about her that was treated hostile and that God was going to come to her defense, you know, and that God was going to be there for her and that no matter who came against her. So I just want to encourage you this morning that you're like, you know what, preacher, I never thought about it before, but there's been some things that have happened in my life, whether it was in my marriage or my relationships or my childhood or whatever the case, that have affected me. But guess what? God, if you will endure and you will trust in him, he can get you through and he can bring healing and he can teach you a new way. Amen. The second person I want to talk to you about is Rahab. And we have to read about her. Let me just tell you the story real quick about Rahab. She lived in a city called Jericho. Y'all know that. That was one of our trivia questions last night. The walls of Jericho. Whenever the children of Israel were going to move into the promised land, that was the first stronghold that had to come down, right? And spiritually speaking, there's a lot of times there's strongholds in our life, and God's wanting to bring us into a place of victory. But until those strongholds come down, then we don't see ourselves crossing over. But nevertheless, the story is that the children of Israel sent two spies into Jericho to find out what was going on. Well, they ended up finding Rahab the harlot, and she was in their house. Well, somehow the word got out that the two spies went into her house, and the king of the city or the leader of the city said, "Hey, bring those spies out." And what Rahab did was she hid them. She took a chance. And she said, "Oh, they came, but they went. And so y'all need to go look for him over there." And in the meanwhile, whenever she's talking to them, she said, "Listen, I've seen what's taking place on the other side. We saw what happened on the other side of the Jordan. We saw what y'all did to the king of Sihon and the king of Og, who was a giant. We saw how you destroyed their armies." And she understood that the same thing that happened to them was going to happen to Jericho. And so she cried out for deliverance, because she knew that the God that they serve could bring deliverance. And so what ended up happening was they said, "Hey, if you keep our business to yourself, then whenever we come in here, we will bring deliverance to you," right? And that ultimately, the Bible says that she let them down with a cord. You know what's interesting to me? Out of all the times that I read the Bible, that this just stuck out to me. And y'all might think that it's funny because y'all might have noticed it the first time. The same cord that she let him down with is the same one cord that she hung out of the side of her window. The same cord. It was a red cord, a scarlet cord. But what I never really caught before, I always knew that. I always just paid attention to the fact that she hung a scarlet cord outside of her window. I never paid attention to the fact that it was the same cord that she let them down with. The same cord that saved them saved her. And you know, this is a whole completely different side note. I do want you to know that the same plan of salvation is for Gentile that it is for Jew. Amen. And it has to do with the shedding of blood. But it was that same cord that brought salvation to both of them. They said, "You hang that cord outside of your window, and whenever we come, you will be delivered." And whenever it was all said and done, they brought, she was delivered in the midst of it all. You know, her name means wide. The name Rahab means wide. You know that scripture, if they would put up there, Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 through 14. So the name Rahab means wide.
And in that scripture, I couldn't help but think about the fact that it says, straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leads. Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way which leads unto life. And few there be that find it. So with Rahab, I was saying knowledge. But I was talking about knowledge, not just scientific knowledge, not just knowledge just to have trivial knowledge, but knowledge about God. And the fact of the matter is that there's people on this earth that just don't know God. They don't know God. They were brought up, I'm not going to go into the whole story, but I've told y'all in the church the story of the time I was on Bourbon Street preaching with that guy witnessing, and that dude from France who had just gotten a mechanical engineering degree stopped there and he could not understand what I was doing on the street talking about some man named Jesus that died on a cross, and it drove him absolutely crazy because he was raised in Europe where they did not believe in the inspiration of the scriptures. He had heard of a man named Jesus, but he certainly did not believe the story. And the point that I'm trying to make is this, is that his other two friends, all they had their mind on was moving forward in the midst of the party, but this dude, even though he didn't believe the Bible, something was happening to him. He was being drawn by the Holy Spirit to stay there and to hear something because he was hearing a story that he just really did not know and he didn't understand it. The point that I'm trying to make is this. There's a whole lot of people out there that have a lot of knowledge and have heard even about the Lord. But in certain situations, what happens is that whenever they hear, so they just don't know. There's a lot of people that don't know, they don't know any better. And they're just moving forward in life like Rahab was. She was a prostitute. She was the prostitute of the city. It just is what it is. But yet now she's in the genealogy of Jesus. She was a prostitute. She was living in the midst of sin. This is how she made her money. And there's no way to sugarcoat it or to make it look any better. But the reality of it is this. When she heard the story about the God that was on the other side of the Jordan, that was bringing judgment and wrath upon powerful enemies, and she knew that same God and his people were all the way over there, she believed some things. She believed, number one, that judgment and wrath had happened in the past and that it was going to happen again coming up. And she also believed that God could deliver her. And she trusted by faith and she began to move in that particular direction. All she needed was a little bit of knowledge to change, a little bit of understanding to change her perception of God and to change her willingness and to believe in the right thing, right? But there's a lot of times whenever people will hear about God, and even though they believe that it's real, the reality of it is that they don't really move in that direction. They don't really move towards allowing God to do a work in the midst of their life because they just don't really believe it. I don't know if you've ever talked to people like that before. They just don't really believe that it's real, and it doesn't change anything. It doesn't have any influence in the midst of their life. But whenever you see somebody that the Holy Spirit, how do we figure out why this one and not that one? You know, there's been a lot of arguing in the church over that. I don't want to get into all that right now, but why, when you tell this person, it's just like there's nothing at all there. And then you tell this person, it's like they light up and they believe and they receive it. It's not our job to figure out who's going to respond and who's not. It's just our job to tell others. I just need you to know that there's a wide, broad road out there. Her name, Rahab, means wide. There's a whole lot of people traveling down that road and they're heading in a particular direction. Amen. But along that way, that we're going to cross some of those people's paths. And if we'll let them know and give them a little bit of knowledge about the Lord, that there's hope and a chance that they also would receive the Lord in the midst of it all. You know, one other thing that I wanted to talk about Jericho is that I kind of did a little bit of research on Jericho. If you could throw up there Deuteronomy 34:3. This is what the Bible says about Jericho. It says, "And the south in the plain of the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees unto Zoar." It called Jericho the city of palm trees. I did some research on Jericho, and the thing that made it so special, it's one of the longest continuously inhabited cities known in the world. In other words, on a continuous basis, there have been civilizations that have dwelled in the midst of that city known as Jericho. And one of the main reasons is because it has a bunch of living springs. And anybody that knows anything about a dry and arid land knows that where springs are, there's water. Where water is, there's palm trees, because it's like an oasis, right? So the point that I'm trying to make is this, is that people in the midst of the world, they were gravitating to this place. It would be a very difficult thing to leave a place like that. It was lush. It was beautiful. You go outside of there, you don't know where your next watering hole is. We saw the children of Israel in their journey. They had a whole lot of problems with water, right? And the reality of it is that in the world system, in the world that we live in today, there's a whole lot of people that don't want to leave their watering hole. There's a whole lot of people that don't want to leave where they are because they've come complacent in the midst of that situation. They've gotten used to living their life a particular way. And the reality of it is that it was a big step for Rahab the harlot to believe God and to take a step of faith and to move out of what she had always known and to move into the narrow path. Straight is the gate, narrow is the way that leads unto salvation. But that's what she did. Amen. She believed God and she moved in the right direction. All right, Ruth, she represents the hungry. In Ruth chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, the hungry or the motivated. What is it that motivates you? It says in Ruth chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, Ruth, now it became to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons, and the name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi, and the name of his two sons Mahlon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem, Judah. And they came into the country of Moab and continued there. And Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left, and her two sons. And they took them wives of the women of Moab. The name of the one was Orpah, and the name of the other Ruth. And they dwelled there about 10 years. So, once again, this whole story is built around famine and is built around hunger. The point that I'm just really trying to make with all this is that people are driven by various hungers that are in the inside of their life. You know, theirs was a physical situation. This place, Bethlehem, the name Bethlehem, I mean, many of you know this, literally means the house of bread. How interesting that Jesus, the bread of life, would be born in this town called Bethlehem, which means the house of bread. But there was no bread in the house of bread. There was a famine in the land. And because of that, these people made a choice to go to another place. And because of that choice, these two boys ended up marrying two girls that were from that place, which really were women that they weren't supposed to marry. But what ends up happening is that because of the hunger, the situation takes place that these boys die. And so they're left now we're talking hunger on another level. Now we're talking hunger in emotional. Something now emotionally is driving them forward. And if you read the story, we're not going to go there for sake of time, but if you read the story, what ends up happening is that after all this aftermath happens, they say that there's bread back in Bethlehem. So Naomi, who is an Israelite, she's going to go back to the place that she knows that she's supposed to be anyway. She's got property. She's got people over there, right? And so she's heading back that way. And originally in the story, her two daughter-in-laws are coming with her. But then she stops in the middle of the journey. She said, what are y'all doing? And even if I found a man today and got pregnant and had, she didn't say twins, but had twins, are you going to sit here and wait around long enough for them boys to grow up and marry them? Y'all need to go back to your families. Y'all need to go back to your families and the people that you know. And immediately, one of them, her name was Orpah, she's like, that just makes sense. I kiss you, I love you, but I'm on my way. She wasn't ready. She was hungry. She wasn't hungry for the same thing that Ruth would end up being hungry for. But Ruth, on the other hand, in the midst of this particular situation, she ends up telling Naomi, she says, no, it's not going to be. She's basically, what she said was this, is that my people now are your people. Your God is now my God. Amen. I'm going to die where you die. I'm going to live where you live. There was something that was hunger, some type of hunger that was on the inside of Ruth that was driving her forward to go with Naomi. I don't believe that she knew exactly what it was, but I do know this. She knew what her past was. She had seen her past. She knew what she had waiting for her back at home. She had been there already. She had seen her family. She knew them all by name. She didn't want to go back to them. She knew the town that she was from. She knew what she could expect. She even knew whether or not there was food there physically ready to be eaten. But the reality of it is that none of that stuff, just like Rahab left Jericho and its palm trees and its water, Ruth was willing to leave behind all of those things that she knew from her past and move forward to wherever it was that God was going to bring her, because there was something that was driving her, something that was making her hungry to move towards the will of God. She didn't even understand it all, but now you and I can look backwards and understand God had a big old plan for your life, Ruth, because she ends up marrying a man named Boaz, and they have a son named Obed, and Obed has a son named Jesse, and Jesse has a son named King David. And who would have ever thought in a million years that some little Moabitish girl would end up being in the genealogy of King David, much less Jesus, the Savior of the world? But there was a hunger that was stirring on the inside of her heart, and she didn't really even understand completely where it was coming from, but it drove her forward. I guess if I was going to stop right now and just ask a simple question for the preacher too, what is it that we're hungry for? What is it that we're hungry for? What is it that is motivating us to move forward in the midst of life? What are we looking to? Because the rest of the story, you can see it centers around hunger. I mean, this girl, she goes to work in the field. She's reaping the sheaves. You know, sheaves meaning big old bundles of grain. She's working, and it's all surrounding the concept of grain and harvest. And we know that God's got a big old harvest plan for humanity. And but the question is, what is it that drives us forward? You know, I started thinking real quick about bread, because that's the final product of grain. And that's what they were doing. They were harvesting grain in the midst of this story. You know, in the proverb, it says that it's that a man goes to work, I'm paraphrasing, because his hunger drives him. Now, in today's society, it's not so much that'd be the case, right? Because, I mean, many times, you know, we get checks from the government and various things like that. They didn't have government checks back in the day. They just didn't have it. I'm not saying that it's all a bad thing, okay? I don't want to get into all that. I talked to a guy that used to live in Norway the other day, but one day maybe I'll talk to you about that, but we won't get into it. But what I am trying to say is, like, even in the story of Ruth, what they did, the law said you don't reap the edges of the field, meaning you don't cut off the corners. And so what Ruth had to do, because she didn't have no money, guess what she had to do? She had to get out there, and she had to go pick up the leftover stuff that was there. She had to go work for her government assistance, if you will. The point that I'm trying to make is this. Is that the proverb says it's a man's hunger that drives him forward. What does that mean? It's a simple way of saying, because I got bills to pay, I get back up and I go to work. Because I got responsibilities that I have to face tomorrow, I get up and I go do the right thing. And even when it don't go my way, I get up the next day and I go do it again. Because there's certain things because I'm hungry. I'm hungry, and if I don't get up and go get my piece of bread, ain't nobody gonna go get it for me. Does that make sense? And one of the things I was thinking is that, you know, whenever back in those days when they would put that seed of grain in the ground, you know what they were thinking? They were thinking one day this seed's gonna turn into a sproutling, and one day, next thing you know, we're gonna have all this grain. And we're going to harvest this grain, and then we're going to take this grain, we're going to separate the chaff from it, we're going to grind this grain down, and guess what we're going to do? We're going to make some bread out of it. And then once we have the bread, we're going to be able to eat it. Amen? I got to tell you that it's not that different in your spiritual life. That God desires for you, that the gospel is a seed. The gospel is a seed that's planted on the inside of your heart, and if you'll allow it to and you'll protect it, it'll start to grow. And it'll grow to the place where one day the promise is actually going to be fulfilled. Amen? I want to encourage you this morning. You can take that in the physical, literal. You can get up tomorrow and you can go back to work, and you can be faithful each and every day, and you can be like that policeman that one day. That, oh, no, it's too late. No, it's never too late. God will bless your desire to do the right thing. Amen? And so I just want to encourage you to move forward in that. So Ruth, she represents the hungry or the motivated. And the question, once again, is that what is it that we are being hungry and motivated by? The last person that I want to talk about has to do with, that was Bathsheba. You know, her name, I said unexpected. Because some unexpected circumstances happened to her. I'm going to try to hustle up a little bit. I know we're running a little bit behind, but Her name, Bathsheba, means the daughter of an oath. You know, an oath is a promise, oftentimes given in the sense of somebody giving God a promise. So what I saw in that is that she represents people that really do want to live for God. Her name means daughter of an oath. She represents the person who has given their heart to God and wants to live for the Lord and has made a decision to do that. But in her circumstance, in her situation, something happens to her that she wasn't really expecting. We don't have time to turn there, but if you would read the story out of 2 Samuel chapter 11 and really just as verses 1 through 5, what you see in the midst of this story is that it was a time frame whenever all the kings would go out to war. And the Bible says that David made a decision to stay home. He sent his army, he sent his generals to go out and fight, but what David did was he stayed home at the palace. You know, and so that was the first thing. And then he comes out in the day. I don't know what time it was. I don't think it really tells us what time it is. He comes out in the midst of the day and he views, and on the rooftop, he sees a beautiful woman bathing. I was just stopping and thinking, trying to think, what if David would have made a different decision that day? You know, what if he would have decided to go into battle instead of staying behind? That would have probably changed this situation a good bit. What if Bathsheba, for whatever reason, would have decided to, I don't know, maybe change her bathing time? Not because she knew anything was going to happen, but just like, I just don't feel like bathing this time. I like taking my bath, but I think I'm going to bathe maybe at 3 in the afternoon instead of 10 in the morning. And she just did that for about 2 or 3 weeks. And then David all of a sudden started feeling like, man, why did I send my boys to fight? And I need to be back in battle. I'm just trying to say, you see how simple a few different movements really affected a situation that it could have, something, different choices, different circumstances could have made the whole scenario different, but that's not what happened. His choice, and it wasn't her fault, she's just taking a bath, minding her own business, doing her thing, and then the next thing you know, he sees her, and he sees that she's beautiful. He's overcome with a situation in this particular circumstance that, he could have said no. Any human being can say no. I mean, I'm not trying to say that sometimes sin doesn't overpower us, because we know when we're operating in our own willpower that it does. Truth to be told, Bathsheba could have begged the king and said no. But we got to understand, too, that she was in a situation. She's kind of like also like the way Tamar was. Not only is she a woman in a man's society, but now she's actually a peasant and there's a king here. But not only that, when you read the story of David, the reality of it is that King David, all the men revered him. I mean, you got to remember the story as a teenage boy that he sunk a rock in a giant's head and cut his head off. And then, I mean, you want to talk about a warrior, he cut his head off. You can only imagine the blood and everything. And then he brought it to Jerusalem. And, you know, he wasn't allowed to bring it inside the city walls because that would have been considered unclean. But I pictured this stuff in my mind and I'm thinking to myself, this dude is riding around on a horse with the head of this giant and he's over here parading victory. And the people have this in their mind and they realize, and then he was anointed king, and then they started singing songs about him. And all the girls in the city would sing songs about him. And they would sing, Saul killed his thousands, David killed his tens of thousands. Then the Bible talks about how good looking he was. The Bible says he was very good, goodly to look at. All right. And so what I'm trying to say is, here's poor Bathsheba. She finds herself in the midst of a situation. She's just minding her own business. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, this king summons her and asks her to come into the situation. And then the next thing you know, she's impregnated. And then the next thing you know, he takes it another step and tries to hide it, and her husband's dead. The point that I'm trying to make is this. I don't think David planned on all this happening, because I know he loved God. But the reality of it is now you got this mixed up mess of something that was completely unexpected. And now you can say it whatever you want, but it's changed their life forever. A completely unexpected situation that they would have never envisioned in a million years, I would imagine. But nevertheless, now it's happened and it's turned into, it's a big old mess. What I want you to know is that Jesus has showed up even for those unexpected situations. Big difference between when you're going to look for sin, right? We know the difference, right? And it unexpectedly comes upon you. The Word of God says in Galatians chapter 6, and we're closing with this. Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 through 2. Brethren, If a man be overtaken in a fault, you which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. The word overtaken there describes someone who was caught unexpectedly in sin. And the way that the scripture encourages us to respond to that is that we would do it with gentleness and meekness. What does that mean? Not with a haughty spirit. How many times have you talked to somebody on the slick out there? You know, I'm just trying to say, like, you know, because some of y'all know each other, right? Through other situations and circumstances. I hope maybe when I say this, it'll kind of like cause a little in your ear, whatever, the next time you find yourself. But how many times do you find someone that you heard something went down in their life, and then the next thing you know, you're like talking about what's going on in their life? And the only question, we've all done it. The only question I would ask you is that, what is the motivation in your heart? How are you feeling about that situation that you're talking about? Oh yeah, so-and-so got da-da-da-da-da, whatever the deal is. And it's kind of like, how do you feel about that? Do you feel some joy in your heart because somebody got jacked up? You feel some joy in your heart because somebody got caught up in a mess? And it's like, I knew it wasn't all that, you know. So my question is that, because you gotta question yourself. You gotta question, what is the motives of your heart? Do you want people to fall on their face? Do you want people to get messed up? Do you want people to get hurt and to fall away? Or are you willing to realize that, but for the grace of God, that's you? Or even with the grace of God, that's you, because you still going in your own direction that you ain't supposed to be going in. The point that I'm trying to make is this, is that whenever we minister to people, we need to understand we don't know all of their situation. We don't know all of the circumstances that have taken place, and that sometimes unexpected situations take people by surprise, and they find themselves in the midst of a circumstance that they really had no clue that was going to happen. There's a lot of things on this earth that happen to us that formulate the way we think, right? We went through some of these things, but what we need to understand is that the unifying factor to all of them is that God used these women to bring Jesus to us, amen?
Amen?
And at the same time, he will allow many of these circumstances to bring us to Jesus. Praise God.